We unfortunately must start with bad news for NASA's Artemis program. NASA's fiscal year 2021 budget will not be increased, but will stay flat at 2020 levels. At first glance, this doesn't sound too bad, but we're going to tell you why we think that this is actually really, really bad for the chances of landing astronauts on the moon by 2024. And then another bombshell from NASA and our favorite company, Boeing.
Starliner's maiden flight review has been completed, and the results are just brutal. But then even more bad news. Some environmental groups are urging the FAA to conduct a new environmental impact assessment for SpaceX's Boca Chica launch site. What does that mean for SpaceX? And what are the consequences for Starship and Super Heavy? And of course, we have to talk about the current progress of Starship at Boca Chica. A lot to cover again, so stay tuned.
So it has unfortunately happened. What we feared came true. We talked extensively about NASA's fiscal year 2021 to 2025 budget request and stated that this increase in NASA's budget would be extremely important to make the 2024 moon landing goal a reality. For example, in this video here. Because estimates showed that in order to really make that ambitious goal, NASA would need $30 billion in additional funds. But we also warned that it would be unfortunately likely that this budget request would not pass Congress. And lo and behold, so indeed it came to pass. But then you might say, hey, come on, don't be so negative. At least the 2021 budget will stay at 2020 levels. That's not so bad, right? Because 2020 levels means $22.5 billion. That's almost $1 billion more than in 2019 and around $2 billion more than in 2018. So that's not so bad, right? Poor Jim Bridenstine tries to convince himself of that and puts on his laughing Joker face, wipes away the tears which he is shedding secretly, and pretends that this is actually a quote, important first step in this year's appropriations process. Well, that's also a way to put it. This should be taught in future classes as a case study on political correctness.
Of course, poor Jim Bridenstine, as we often said, has the most difficult job on this planet, and he cannot speak out the obvious truth. But fortunately, dear viewers, we can. What this House Appropriations Bill from the 7th of July actually means is nothing less than the de facto death of the 2024 crewed moon landing. Before you brutally flame us in the comment section, which you probably will do either way, let us elaborate. NASA asked for $25.24 billion, but got almost $3 billion less. Where do you think the $3 billion will be cut from? SLS? Please. No, of course, the human landing systems for Artemis. So the moon landers for 2024 themselves. You know that not long ago, three companies were awarded a total of $967 million to develop a human lander for the 2024 moon landing, with $579 million for the lobby moon lander. So here, kids, you really see that lobbying does pay off. Then $253 million for Dynetics team, whose lander we find far superior to the lobby team's lander. And only $135 million for the absolutely totally superior Moon Starship, which could actually carry the entire lobby lander as payload, like in this quite hilarious rendering here. Whoever made this, dear sir or madam, you are a genius.
But for the entire human landing systems, we can see that around $3.3 billion would have been foreseen for 2021, which is this difference here in exploration, research and development. Instead of $3.3 billion, NASA now got a meager $628 million, so only 19% of the request. 19%! So what Jim tries to sell us as an important first step is actually a total disaster. Because without a moon lander, obviously, there can't be a moon landing. At least not in 2024. And let's be brutally realistic. If NASA would get the needed budget only in 2022. That would probably be already too late. So this year, ladies and gentlemen, means nothing less than that the probability of a moon landing by 2024 has just dropped to a maximum of, we'd say, 10%. And the probability wasn't extremely high before, as it was. And even though Jim also tried to sell us the bill as bipartisan, of course, super politically correct as always, in reality, the Republican Congress members seem to be not so happy with the bill. For example, Republican subcommittee ranking member Robert Aderholt called out the bill's deficiency. He said that the reduced funding for Artemis is a rebuke, especially considering the quote, passion of the American people for a reinvigorated space program as evidenced by the launch of the Demo 2 mission. Full committee ranking member Kay Granger went even further. She said, quote,
"This bill makes new investments in science, but only selectively. There's a significant increase for the National Science Foundation, but there's not a penny more for NASA. Specifically, the bill fails to provide adequate funding for an essential component of NASA's Artemis program, the human landing systems, on which the first woman will travel to the surface of the moon. The inadequate amount included for landers undermines prior year investments in deep space exploration. Flat funding for NASA reveals a deliberate effort to undercut our path toward renewed American space dominance. This is short-sighted, to say the least. Being the world leader in space will be expensive, but it won't be nearly as costly as letting China dominate in space. For far too long, we have allowed China to challenge us, with negative implications both for our economy and our national security."
Dear Mrs. Granger, thanks a lot for saying something about which we on this channel have been warning about since day one. If the US lets the moon landing effort slip, China will certainly take advantage of it. And let's be crystal clear, China is planning to land their people on the moon by around 2030. If the US doesn't get their own people to the moon by 2024, there is a real chance that we'll be looking at Chinese moon supremacy. So bipartisan, doesn't really sound bipartisan to us. We have the strange feeling that a certain political party wants to delay Artemis as long as possible until after 2024. We wonder why. We wonder why this could be. Fortunately, Republican Congressman Michael Waltz can help us out here. He said, quote, "I'm a little bit worried. The president has been clear. The vice president has been clear. We want to get boots on the moon by 2024, and you know I'm just being probably more candid here than some of our other speakers. There are those that don't want to see this administration have that victory."
Well, well, well. What can we say? Nothing to add here. And normally we'd say, okay, so what? Then the US lands on the moon by 2026 or 2028. Where is the problem? The problem is that the next president in 2024 will most likely just undo everything this one did. A good old American tradition. So the likelihood for Artemis being cancelled altogether is quite high. That's the real problem here. So the only chance, yes, the only chance now the US has, is to hope that Starship will be ready in the next years, and SpaceX will carry out their own private moon missions to the lunar surface in the next 4 to 5 years. Because then Congress will have no choice but to use Starship for America's return to the moon. So let's hope that it will happen like this. Because if not, then this here is what's going to await us. But if you thought that the rant was over, we're just getting warmed up here. The results of the major review conducted by NASA and Boeing of Starliner's maiden flight have now been published. And once again, it confirms everything we said. NASA Commercial Crew Program Manager Steve Stitch identified insufficient NASA oversight on Boeing, which allowed multiple software problems to go unnoticed before launch. At the same time, there was increased oversight over SpaceX's software development for Crew Dragon. He further said that more resources may have been dedicated to oversight at SpaceX due to their less traditional approach of software development compared to Boeing's method, with which NASA was more comfortable.
So NASA was more comfortable with Boeing's approach, You know, it's quite funny because people often accuse us of being too aggressive and too negative on Boeing and that we might exaggerate sometimes. But we said in this episode here exactly that, that NASA is super strict on SpaceX and far too lenient on Boeing. And we all know why. Because Boeing has good lobbyists and Boeing's spaceflight program is basically a giant NASA-funded job creations program. They lobbied lots of Congress people and have strong political support, even though they have inferior products and inferior software development as compared to SpaceX. And the leniency of NASA almost made the Starliner flight end in disaster. Because Doug Lovero admitted back then that the Starliner flight was a high visibility close call. And now what will happen with Starliner? Well, NASA has only 80, repeat, 80 recommendations for Boeing to implement for the next Starliner launch. Only 80 recommendations. I mean, come on, that's not so bad. So good luck for the next launch attempt, Boeing. You will probably need it.
This week is really brutal. What's going on? We have even more bad news. Some environmental groups are urging the FAA to require a new environmental impact assessment for Boca Chica. Members of the Friends of the Wildlife Corridor are not amused that SpaceX changed their Boca Chica Starship facility from a launch site to a test site with, quote, ongoing experimentation of untested technology without doing the studies that would ensure environmental protection and public safety and without giving the local community a chance to have a say. We can understand that some residents of the area are not so happy about SpaceX's Boca Chica facility. But SpaceX has to conduct their tests somewhere on this planet, right? And no matter where SpaceX would build a facility, you can be sure that there would be wildlife nearby. We are pretty sure that there's also wildlife at Cape Canaveral, but that didn't prevent the Saturn V to be built and launched, right? So we hope that the FAA will do the right thing. Because as we said, nothing less than the US dominance in space is on the line here. Because SpaceX is the only one who can land astronauts on the moon before China. No one else can do this. But we think that one of the reasons why SpaceX wants to build floating platforms for super heavy launches is in part exactly due to that. The fear that the FAA will restrict super heavy testing at Boca Chica. With the floating launch platforms, SpaceX will be able to conduct offshore launches, not bound by any FAA regulations. And of course, also solving the noise problem of super heavy at the same time. A genius move by Elon, and really necessary as you can see here.
As for Boca Chica itself, a lot is happening as always. Last week we were maybe a bit too optimistic, we admit. This week we'll try to remain more realistic. So SN5 got a mass simulator installed, probably in order to simulate the mass distribution of the nose cone, which will be important for the upcoming hopping tests. But of course, before the hopping tests, SN5 will first have to survive the static fire tests, which are, according to current road closure dates, starting today with backup dates on the 14th and the 15th of July. So if the static fire tests this week should go well, we might see the hopping test next week. Meanwhile, much to the dismay of the Friends of the Wildlife Corridor, SpaceX has started building the giant Super Heavy high bay building where the Super Heavy will be stacked. This building will be an insane 81 meters tall when finished, and we can see the giant cranes building this massive structure. Meanwhile, sections for a further test tank and future starships are already being transported around, indicating that work until at least SN10 is already being carried out. And if you're new to this channel and would like to know why colonizing the moon in the first place might be a very good idea, you can watch this video here.
So thanks for watching the JS Space Report. Then I would say, on to the future.
Perfect. What Artemis stuff, right? Mm-hmm.